morning, everyone. I am Brother Matthew. Thank you for tuning in once again to listening to our powerful program that is being delivered by our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Umoye.
Good morning, everybody. This is the day the Lord has made, and I will be glad and rejoice in it. Are you going to rejoice? Close your eyes and open your mouth and tell the Lord, today there will be no complaint, there will be no conflict, and then there will be no contention. Open your mouth, tell the Lord, today is a day of rejoicing. This is the day the Lord has made, and you will be glad and rejoice in it. The joy of the Lord will be our strength. That the Lord himself that has made a day like this gives us the reason to rejoice. Christ is born. Joy to the world. And good news, goodwill unto all men. That the Lord today will bring the joy in your heart and the praises from your soul. And that will bring you strength and great power. Praising the Lord. Rejoicing before the Lord. Saying, Lord, here we are. You as an individual. And we as members of the spiritual Christian family. The joy of the Lord will be in your heart. You have a reason to rejoice if you are born again. You are a child of God. You have a reason to rejoice. And that is the kind of joy that brings miracle. The kind of joy that brings the presence of the Lord. And the kind of joy that gives you power for your hour. Power for your hour. Hour of trial, there's power. For the hour of temptation, there is power. For the hour of troubles and tribulations, there is power. That the power of God will soon work in your life. And when that power is at work, what great joy we have. What strength, what ability we have. The freedom to express your joy in the sight and the presence of the Lord. Makes you strong, mighty and powerful. Commit yourself to the Lord, that your life will not be a life of complaining, a life of murmuring, a life of grumbling. At all times, in all things, with all people, in all situations, praise the Lord. Glorify the Lord. Then are you going to experience the power for your hour? Make this retreat special by committing your heart, your life, everything you've got to the praise of the Lord. You commit yourself to the Lord that you'll praise the Lord in difficult times, perilous times, painful times, perplexing times. Are you going to find life will change when you commit yourself to praising the Lord every time? Life will change. Because it's that praise, that glorifying the Lord, that brings the miracle you desire. Praising the Lord always. Praising the Lord always. In the dungeon at midnight, in all situations when things go wrong, if you praise the Lord, He'll make them right. The God of the mountain is the God of the valley, and the God of the good times is the God of the bad times. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. The God of the day is the God of the night too. Praising, worship Him, glorify Him. In Jesus' name we pray. Did I hear your amen? In Jesus' name we pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for such a day like this. We thank you for the sunshine. We thank you for the rain. We thank you for the light. We thank you for the midnight. We thank you, Lord, for everything we go through in life, because we know all things work together for good for those who are called by the Lord, those who are called according to your purpose. We pray that, Lord, today it will be a time, a day, a period of praising the Lord all the rest of our lives, in Jesus' name. Lord, we're committing ourselves to you. There will be no complaints today. There will be no conflict today. And there will be no combat with anybody today, in Jesus' name. We pray that the love of God will bring the joy of the Lord to the very surface of the heart of everyone, in Jesus' name. And as we rejoice before you, as we praise your name, as we glorify you, great, mighty, marvelous things will be taking place, in Jesus' name. Put your praise in every heart. The glory of the Lord will fall, and the power of the Lord will be known. And Lord, we pray, no situation will remain the same, in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Before you sit, everybody give me another amen. Thank you very much. We're looking at something very peculiar today. You know, many people, when they read their Bibles, they never are able to get anything new, anything special, anything peculiar from the Word of God. That's the reason, by the way, why many people, they read the Bible every day, they study the Bible every week, and they listen to messages and preaching almost every time, and yet their lives never change. The situations remain the same, because they never change anything, whatever they read. But today, we're going to change a lot of things. I said we're going to change a lot of things. The situation in your life, the peculiarity in your life, the perplexity in your life. How does everything turn around? How do you know that today you are starting? It's like there's sorrow, you want to move to joy. There's sickness, you want to move to health. There's bondage, you want to move to deliverance. There's imprisonment, you want to move to dominion. How do you make that transition in your life? You know, the thing people know is that we turned Christianity in this continent of Africa. We turned Christianity into a rhythm of pray for me, pray for me, pray for me. And I think it's, you know, as I look at the church, I'm not just talking about this church, Deeper Life, I'm talking about the church at large. You know a lot of things that the people of the world who do not read their Bibles, what they are brought in. I say a lot of things that the people are brought in into the church. And then the things that are there, especially in the Acts of the Apostles, which is the story of the church. The story of the church on the move. The story of the church triumphant. A lot of things there, many people do not understand. And I want to bring to your attention this morning one of those things. I'm sure you've read this before. I'm sure you've learned this before. I'm sure you've had messages on this before. But as I read this, what do I see? Let's come to Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. Acts of the Apostles chapter 16, I'm reading from verse 20. It says, and brought them to the magistrate, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city, and they teach customs which are not lawful for us to receive, neither to observe, being Romans. And the first thing I notice here is that they brought Paul and Silas before the magistrates. And the one reason they gave is this: Paul and Silas, they're teaching something different, something strange, something not according to their custom, something not according to their law. And they said, in particular, because we are Romans. Well, when you have the word Romans, I want you to look at verse 36. In verse 36, and the keeper of the prison told this, saying to Paul, the magistrates have said to let you go. Now, therefore, depart and go in peace. Have you ever read where somebody was put in prison unlawfully? And then the magistrates thinking through, they said, okay, let those people go. If you were, what will you do? You run out immediately. You say, praise the Lord. And Paul was not in a hurry to run out of the prison. Did you ever think about that? Imprisonment is not a good thing. Restriction is not a good thing. I mean, hell distorts overnight. It's not a good thing. Now you can go. Look at what Paul said in verse 37. But Paul said unto them, they are beating us openly, uncondemned, being Romans. Being Romans. I'm saying, Paul, what didn't you tell them when they said they were Romans? What didn't you tell them? Hey, big deal. I'm a Roman too. I was born there. I have the same citizenship as you. And then you would have been free. No, he said, we don't tell them what God does not allow us to tell them. But no, if you had told them you were a Roman, they would not have done that to you. He said, it doesn't matter. God has a purpose for taking me into that prison. And now that the purpose has been fulfilled, I can now tell them I am a Roman too. And then they have cast us into the prison. And now do they thrust us out privately? Nay, verily, but let them come themselves and fetch us out. Verse 38. And the sergeants told these words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they, both Silas and Paul, were Romans. We learned something there, that you're not too quick to get out of trouble and give all the reasons why this should not be happening to you. Because if you allow everything going on to happen, you'll find a miracle you wouldn't have discovered if you didn't go into the prison. The situation happening to you today, if it didn't happen, you'll not see some miracles. And the predicament you're going through, and the restriction you're going through, and the bad things you think are happening. Why is this happening? Why is this happening? Why is this happening? If those things did not happen, you'll not have the record of Acts chapter 16. You're not of the miracle that is recorded here. we learn a lesson. Don't jump out. Don't hurry up. And then run away from that situation. Let what is happening happen. And say, Lord, you must have something to bring out of this. To bring out of this condition. I'm coming back to verse 22. And the multitude rose up together against them. And the magistrates rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. And at midnight, Paul and Silas did what? Tell me out loud. Prayed. And then did what? Are you there? And did what? And sang praises unto God. And the prisoners had them. You know what? I know some people, they only sing in church. They don't sing at home. I know some people, they only sing in good times. They don't sing in bad times. I know some people, they only sing in at noon, when the sun is shining, when everything is bright, when there is prosperity. They don't sing in the midnight, when there is adversity, when there is persecution, when there is opposition. By the way, this is the only singing I find in the Acts of the Apostles. You look at Acts chapter 1, there was prayer meeting, but no singing. You look at Acts chapter 2, there was the outpouring of the Spirit of God, but no singing. You look at chapter 3, there was miracle, but no singing. You look at chapter 4, there is this extensive prayer, and the whole church came together, and there was no singing, and no drumming either. You know, a lot of things that have come into the church, the disco that has come to the church, the dancing that has come to the church, the pop house night club music that has come into the church, and they sing. We cannot have a prayer meeting except there is drumming and dancing. And they sing. We cannot have a night vigil in the church without drumming and singing and dancing. A lot of things that those people that were musicians in the world before. And then they come into the church. They say they are born again. And they're changing virtually everything in the church. But here we have in the prison, in the midnight. Then they sang. You sing like that when things are down.